Josefina, let me thank you for coming so far to participate in our event in Reading, which I think we can safely call a success now. We had such a huge participation in it. And your involvement with the geoengineering issue goes back, I think, quite a ways now, and you have, I would like to know more about that. But first, I understand that you studied here in the States in 73. Can you tell me a little bit about your background and study and what led you to this point with being involved with this issue of climate engineering?
Yes, I came back in 73, yes, far long ago, right? I did my studies in political science in UCLA, Los Angeles, and after I came to Europe, and the Johns Hopkins University has a chapter in Bologna, Italy, so I did, I made there a postgraduate on international relations. Then after that, I think I did a master, 2 years master in rural development, because I was very much interested in rural work, and then a master in public, also 2 years in public administration, because I was very much interested in going into politics as an independent party, which I did, and I didn't have a very good experience as an independent, you know. Anyway, that made me realize that I had to come back to the nonprofit world and start my fight against environmental problems from a non-profit organization. So I created an association called Terra SOS, S-O-S, Sostenible. And this this association, what it does is it creates civic platforms to fight against or to fight any given environmental problem. We don't touch all the environmental problems that there are, because we wouldn't be efficient, so we get one at a time. And right now, since 3 years, we are concentrated only on the subject of geoengineering. That's why we can be efficient, and that's why we took the subject to the European Parliament. We created a platform called Skyguards, a European platform. This platform is composed of associations in over 20 different European countries. So all these associations under the Skyguards platform, we took the problem, our concerns, our denounce to the European Parliament last year. And can you imagine that over 700 members of the European Parliament, there was only one lady that gave us patronizing, you know? She gave us the chance to go to the European Parliament and express the concerns of the European citizens over these skies that have been sprayed since 1999. This lady is called Tatiana. Tatiana, she's from Lithuania. Tatiana Tsanaka.
And actually, we know the skies even going back much further than that. There was a ramp up in the program in 1998, 99, but we know that the spraying's been going on since the late 40s at some level. So isn't it astounding that you said one out of 700?
Yes.
Isn't that astounding?
It's astounding.
That you could have something that's so incredibly visible and so incredibly destructive, and so many people are trying to deny and pretend it's not happening. It's
yes.
Astounding to us.
Plus, this is unforgetful, because in the year 1999, 14th of January, the European Parliament had passed a resolution resolution on environmental issues after the Cold War. There was a lady, Rosalie Bertel and another European parliamentary from Sweden. They decided to draw a report on how these resources that would be left after the Cold War could be employed, military resources could be employed in benefit of environment. And they talk for the first time about HARP and how the need to abolish and to ban these programs. and a hearing was organized for the U.S. Government and for NATO directives, right? And they didn't show up. A few times they organized a hearing for them to say what, to give them the chance to explain what was happening and what was going on with these programs, you know? And they didn't show up. So the resolution was adopted and it was put under the drawer and never talk again. Until that was our, we grasped that possibility of going to the European Parliament to expose this problem because that resolution existed, you know? And we made valid that resolution and we talked about that resolution and we said we have to come back to that resolution and start making a research, an independent research to see what is going on because this is affecting people's life, this is affecting nature, this is affecting every time we breathe, you know, this is affecting our food, everything. So there must be research, an investigation done by the European community.
Well, this is where, again, the scope and scale that this kind of environmental assault can occur without agencies disclosing it, without the public being aware of it, and it's, for me, it's a sad testimony of the human condition now that the environment is virtually imploding around us. I mean, we live here where our current location. I mean, I'm surrounded by forest that was green and thriving only 10 years ago, and now it's dying by the day. Very few animals, as I've mentioned to you, off the air here, and almost no food source because there's almost no berries on anything, and the die-off has been horrible. The trees are dying by the day. Our skies look like something from another planet. I mean, blue skies are gone. The air is very unnatural. It's very dry, staticky. It's like living on another planet. And yet people are so busy with their iPhones and their distractions of American Idol, football games.
Diets.
They don't even seem to perceive that the planet is dying around them. So, and this is profound to me, absolutely profound. So in Spain, is the population, I imagine here that they're more awake in Spain.
But not really, not really. In Spain, well, the problem is that when there is a problem and we don't use the right terms to define the problem, you can get to the people. So in Spain, we have the tendency, not only in Spain, I guess in the rest of the world is also the same, we have the tendency to copy what it comes from the States. You know, it's good to copy the good things, but it's not good to copy the things that are not good.
The Western influence has been
It's incredible, yeah. And so they start talking about the war chemtrails. Nobody understood anything. Of course, you have to, anything that is not self-explanatory, it can get down to people.
Yeah.
So we lost 10 years of activism in a useless debate about if this was a contrail or that was a chemtrail. That's a useless debate because in the meantime, who is doing this had 10 years ahead, you know, to work on the governance of geoengineering,
but
on the
power
governance
structure. To back up what you're saying, the power structure, though, and those who work behind the scenes on the internet, those sort of trolls, if you will, that try to create this division, they certainly try to fuel that debate, contrail versus chemtrail.
Yeah.
They try to fuel that debate. They try to fuel that division. And, of course, we try to stay away from that sort of debate because there is no debate. This is going on. And the geoengineering data is immense. So I agree, a lot of people do make the mistake of engaging in that debate, and we need to move on past that because we have so little time. I mean, the speed at which the biosphere is imploding is beyond belief. It's absolutely beyond belief, and I don't think they can hide this much longer. So I hope what we've done here might help you in Spain, that this event here might serve as a model that you've participated in, but I had hoped that people in Spain might be more awake than the Americans, because the Americans are hopelessly asleep for the most part. But I think that in the coming weeks and months, I think our situation is that dire that I believe some as of yet unimaginable changes are probably very close, because the power structure is getting increasingly desperate as they know they can't hide what they've done. And they still have immense power. As they become desperate, they become more dangerous. And I think that they're capable of, at any point in time, another 9/11 type event to try to lock down society, as they know society is waking up.
Well, I can tell you that as soon as we really won or win the semantic fight, we win the other, because semantic is very important. And when we call things by their names, people understand. And once they understand, you cannot use words that don't belong to people's vocabulary. They don't have emotional relation to these words, and they can't get organized because they are not aware of what it means. Once they get the right message with the right words, people organize, they wake up. And this is what is happening, you know? This is what it got us to the European Parliament. If we had gone to the European Parliament using the work and trades, we wouldn't even pass the first door, you know what I mean? We want to use the terms that are scientific.
Climate engineering, geoengineering.
That's right. Climate manipulation, everybody understands. Yeah. Spraying, everybody understands, even kids in the school.
Yeah.
So that's what we are using. And we encourage people, you know, to really make an effort to change vocabulary so that we can reach mass public opinion.
Because this has been a problem here in the States, that even sincere activists have taken the bait, if you will, from some of the disinformation people, that they have insisted on using the word chemtrails. And they have even insinuated that anybody who doesn't use that word must be a government agent.
Yeah, we are accused of double being double agents.
And this is astounding that people can't think past this ridiculous notion, because to use the science terms is to gain credibility gain awareness. And so a lot of people here have not been able to think past the disinformation that was fed to them, that they accepted and used, and so they stick to this word that is not helpful to our cause. I think that's starting to change now, but you see, even with this event in Reading, where I think 99% of the activists used climate engineering and geoengineering.
And a few of them,
A few, maybe 1 or 2%, still stayed with the old term, and the only term the media used?
Yeah,
was chemtrails.
That's because we were talking about it.
Yeah, they because they want to marginalize the issue. They want people to Google chemtrails and go straight to conspiracy theory and no
science.
They
want to discredit absolutely all the content that was given there.
Exactly. So we're getting past this now a little bit, in that, and we know what the term chemtrails. If you Google it in the Wikipedia definition, I have friends with the Union of Concerned Scientists that have tried to clarify in that definition that the chemtrails term is simply a layman's term for geoengineering, and when they try to do that, their input has been immediately erased. So they watch that definition closely. But at this point, the environmental destruction, as we look out here from this overlook that used to be very beautiful, colorful, very clear views of the distant mountains, now it's completely colorless, bleached out, silvery white, every single day, every day. And the lack of moisture in the air, the lack of precipitation. I told you we're 240 inches of rain short here in this location for the last 7 years. The die-off is so cataclysmic now that even those who denied something was going on are being forced to take notice. And even with the event yesterday, even though there's still a lot of local people that have been convinced that our government would never do anything to harm us, and you know, this the typical brainwashing. Now they're starting to be forced to face the fact, and the geoengineering subject is in their mind now, and now they look around, and I think it's hard for them to deny it, and they're starting to wake up.
That's good. Coming back to what you said about yesterday's event, I think it's very important. After the hearing, I went to the supervisors and talked to them and thanked them, and told them that the positive results that would come out of this hearing as a consequence, you know, of all the witness and proofs, support, would be good for the whole world. The same as the good results that we expect to have out of the investigation of the European Parliament, you know? It's going to help us too. And so they said, please, any results out of the investigation of the European Parliament we would like to have, please keep in touch and send us these results. we have to be very vigilant because we know that European Commission doesn't want this investigation to take place. So, but this investigation must take place. The war of the European Parliament is engaged. It really have to earn their credibility because now, in past elections, we bear got 43% of the votes. No board in no business can develop a project or put a tool in the market with 43% of the votes. That's not possible. So if they don't change, really, if they are not up to what they have to be, it's to defend citizens' rights, they will lose ground. And finally, it'll be an institution that won't serve anyone but corporate interests. Yes.
That's how things are shaping up. But I think so many people, even inside those criminal corporate interests, don't understand the immediacy and totality of what's unfolding around us. That you hear these time frames of different things they want to happen in 2020 and 2030. Mm. If we look mathematically at what's happening to the biosphere right now, the speed at which it's happening, those dates will not come with our reality being what it is now. Won't happen. So at this point, as that illusion shatters, and as people inside those corporate interests realize that the ship is going down now, mm-hmm. and as they start to defect from their former position of saying what they're told to say, doing what they're told to do, I think we're going to see a lot more of those types of defections. And I think we probably already had that. In fact, in the U.S., as Geoengineering awareness rose, we feel it's possible that there might have been some pushback developing in the U.S. government in certain states. And then we see Hurricane Sandy. Remember yes. Hurricane Sandy?
Yes.
Now, I mean, all indications are that that was a engineered storm. Mm-hmm. It was directed. I mean, there's no plausible way that the modelers and the modeling, which is done by Raytheon, by the way, who's also doing the weather modification, there's no way that they could have known if there was anything natural about that storm. They could not have known that storm would take a completely unprecedented 90-degree westerly turn 7 days beforehand. Mm-hmm. They couldn't have known that, but they did. So is this indeed the schedule weather? And with Sandy, because Sandy delivered a big blow to the U.S., and it was also, that storm was very strong, should have been a Category 3 or 4, but we could see on radar them aerosolizing to weaken it before it hit. Mm-hmm. But they still directed it there, and they still did a lot of damage. Was that a warning? Perhaps was that a warning mm-hmm. to certain political leaders that this is what we can do if you don't go along?
Yeah.
This is what we'll do to your state?
Yes.
This is what we'll do to your populations? Is that also a factor, that a lot of these politicians are simply, they lack the courage to take a stand, mm-hmm. so they continue to go along, and things continue to get worse, and the control continues to become more total. So in the case of Hurricane Sandy, perhaps that was a warning to those who don't want to go along. And we see other states that, again, don't go along. Thailand, I've mentioned many times, Thailand in 2011 mm-hmm. refused the U.S. a weather... What they were told was a weather modification
yes.
base. We believe the Thai government knew it was for weather, they were told it was a weather monitoring base. We believe the Thai government knew it was a weather modification base.
Mm-hmm.
Refused. Thailand got wiped out with flooding. So we see a lot of these examples. Pakistan, I've mentioned many times as well. So for the European Parliament, who knows what factor it might be there. As I mentioned, as you got here today, some children were just killed with hail
yes.
on a beach in, I believe, Bosnia. So... they can fire these warning shots, they can wage weather warfare anytime they want. And it appears they're doing exactly that. Exactly that. So here in California, we know that the lack of rain here is a direct result of the aerosolizing that's going on off our coasts, above our storms. There's no question. We see it on satellite. We know the scientific effect. They're cutting off our rain. Period. So how long can that go on before everything's dead?
So you said a few times, I heard you, that the nucleation, the agents that they use in the nucleation of clouds, they burn actually the trees, no?
Incendiary dust, okay? So you have one, you have, as they aerosolize these storms, and we see it happening upstream in the storm track. So the storms are never really allowed to form, as they historically did. So you have these big drifting masses of moisture that have too many condensation nuclei, too many tiny nanoparticulates, which diminishes and disperses the rain. It also shreds the ozone layer, and it sucks the moisture out of the air. And that, because they're desiccants, again, they absorb the moisture. So it has the effect of migrating this moisture across us. So the forest is much, much drier. When it does rain, the rain is toxic. So the trees sense this bioavailable material. They don't uptake nutrients. They become even more weak. And you have now an intense UV because of the shredded ozone.
Mm-hmm.
And you have, yes, as they spray on the drier days and these particles continue to settle down and build up on the foliage, yes, it's an incendiary dust, a flammable dust. And the forest is virtually coated with it. So you have dead, dying, dry trees coated with an incendiary dust. They can only burn more ferociously than ever before. And that's what we see.
We have the same in Europe. And we have seen also, what you explained me, how the leaves of the trees curl.
Yes.
And that's due to the UV.
Yes.
The excess of UV.
Yes, we have enough study on this to confirm that. So the trees are dropping their leaves. They're allowing branches to die. And the leaves will curl up.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're trying to reduce their exposure to this UV, which they can't take.
Yeah.
And we're not talking about, people think if you say the UV levels are high, they think maybe it's 10, 20, 30% high, which would be bad enough. But again, our UV metering has shown UVB levels that are 1,200% higher than we're being told. And this is completely off the scale. And it's killing plankton around the globe. And it's killing terrestrial insects, aquatic insects, destroying the forest. I mean, if no ozone layer, no life on Earth. So we are, even now, even people in our movement, even people in the anti-geoengineering movement, still mostly do not grasp that our situation is very immediate.
Yeah.
It's immediate.
Mm-hmm.
That right now, on any given day, if the power structure plans some sort of false flag event or whatever situation they will orchestrate to try to further clamp down on society, because they can't hide this much longer. I mean, you have harvests crashing in California along the main agricultural areas. They're spraying the trees with chemicals to try to protect them from UV.
Oh.
And the media is not publicizing this. They're actually planting, I speak with the farmers, they're planting more UV-resistant trees around the perimeter
mm-hmm.
of their fields,
mm-hmm.
and they're spraying full-grown mature trees with chemicals to try to protect them from the UV. How long can this go on? How long can it go on? And it's just, those are very desperate measures for a situation that's getting worse by the day. There's only one solution to this, and the climate engineering has to stop. And even if it stops, we face unimaginable challenges. And a lot of people don't get that either yet. You know, it's still it's the right priority, and I'm very glad you're prioritized
yes.
on it. And this is what a lot of the environmentally minded people don't understand. They don't seem to want to understand that if there's a huge hole in the bottom of the boat, that's what you have to focus on.
Mm-hmm.
You don't paint the deck or polish the deck rails. You have to seal the bottom of the boat. And I hope more people wake up to that, because if we don't stop climate engineering, nothing will matter. But even if we stop it, a lot of people don't yet seem to understand permanent damage has been done to the Earth's life system. Permanent in the sense that, based on previous events, we know the recovery period can be, for something even close to this type of event, 10 to 20 million years. And that's permanent for our time scale,
mm-hmm.
for our purposes. So we face unimaginable challenges at best, but that being said, if there's one giant leap I believe we could take in the right direction, is to focus on what you've chosen to focus on.
Well, actually, one of our demands to the European Parliament on the top of the independent investigation was to make legislation in order to have democratic and parliamentary control of military research programs,
mm-hmm.
because that is the most obscure, you know, in the name of national security, in the this is it became a mantra, you know, and so they really commit the most awful crimes.
Yes, they do.
Against humanity.
Yes, they
and
do.
This is one.
This is the biggest one of all. In fact, I don't know if I mentioned to you or if you might have heard, I announced on a few radio shows, but I got a call a week and a half ago from a person who is an architect in these programs.
Mm.
I recognize his name from documentation,
mm-hmm.
not from the very inception, but from the modifications made in the 80s. And it was an interesting conversation because I get the perspective of those on the inside. And it's a very narrow-minded perspective. And they look at this as a risk-to-risk scenario, the risk of doing it
yes.
versus the risk of not doing it. So they make the decision for us. We don't get asked. And their decision is based on, a very narrow field of vision. So he was completely unaware of the cataclysm that's happening on the ground, that they only look at this in terms of their particular part of the equation, and they don't see the wider picture. So the fact that, even the fact that the climate engineering is destroying the ozone layer was, for the most part, out of his field of vision or understanding. And so that's part of the reason how these things go as far as they do. Everybody's making money.
Yes.
It's a job. Everybody has one little part of the equation. Nobody sane is looking at the whole equation. There are certainly those that know, but they're not sane, and they don't seem to care, and they seem to, in their delusion, think that they can, with their money and their power, that they'll always find a way out. And it was enlightening. Again, and I, to this man's credit, he did listen. He listened as well as sharing. And I think he's thinking about a lot of things now that he didn't really realize or understand. We had a good exchange of data. And I hope that somewhere some of this percolates to others that are in these programs, because based on what we see at face value right now, mathematically speaking, and this is a hard point for people to really accept, mathematically speaking, if we stay on this trajectory with the feedback loops that have already been triggered, methane, mass expulsion, ozone depletion, it calculates out to about a 17 to 20 year period for there to be no life left in the northern hemisphere, none. And that's where it calculates out, and there's a number of scientists that are very credible that have confirmed this calculation. Guy McPherson is one from UC Arizona, part of the AMIG group.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at the speed at which the last 10 years we've seen die off, and that's accelerating exponentially,
mm-hmm.
that's where you can really understand how it could be that bad. Because so many people are trained to think that it's all linear. If it's taken 200 years for it to get this bad, it's going to progress at the same rate. It doesn't work that way. If you leap off a cliff, the first 5 feet, you fall at one rate,
mm-hmm.
but as you continue to fall, the rate picks up exponentially.
Yes.
Same equation. So it's very sobering, and people don't want to face this. And I think they're going to have to face it. I think the government knows that once the public knows, there'll be panic. And they're doing everything they can right now to keep that panic from happening. They're artificially inflating the stock market to make it appear that things are great.
Mm-hmm.
They're falsifying temperature records we see here in Northern California. The official temperature readings for any given day are 4 or 5 degrees less than the actual temperature. So they're trying to hide how hot it really is. And from every figure, unemployment. I don't know what the unemployment in Spain is quite bad.
Oh, my God, 26%, right.
Astounding. And maybe it's worse still. I don't know. Here,
yes.
But here we know that if 500,000 people fall off the back of the conveyor where their time is expired and they no longer get benefits, they no longer count.
Yeah.
So the figure goes down even though the unemployment is really going up.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is an illusion.
Yes.
At this point.
But what it really makes us angry as a platform is the fact that these people are doing this on our backs, mm-hmm. on people's, on citizens' back. In name of us, in our name,
mm-hmm.
without our knowledge, without our consent, and they come as saviors. And they are ruling governance of geoengineering, and they are talking on behalf of our civil society. Who the hell gave them the right and the legitimacy, you know, to talk on our behalf?
I share the anger that I sense you feel. I share the exact anger. Who the hell gave them the right? And when people get past watching football games and soccer, and as we just see the World Cup and all these distractions to keep the population busy, to keep them entertained while the planet is virtually destroyed. And that's what we have happening. And this, I feel the same sort of anger, because I would never, you would never exercise that sort of power over somebody else. I could never do that on any scale. And so it's hard for us to understand how those in power, it's hard for me to understand how they can behave in the way they do.
It's only explained by the belief and the fact, confronted to the facts, that we are being ruled by psychopaths.
We are. And this is a fact that...
All over.
We are. And this is not a metaphor or a being facetious, it's a fact. And I do outline this in a lot of presentations, in that we know 4% of society is clinically psychopathic, and that 4% ends up in power every time. Because they'll do things, as I just stated, that you or I wouldn't do. We wouldn't do it. So that's how they end up there, and the blind spot, back to what's happening right now, I believe the power structure knows that the whole ship is going down. And we see increased signs of this, that the power structure is fracturing, that there's infighting, because now there's not enough to go around. The realization of their own mortality is sinking in. I think they're increasingly dangerous for that. And we see that blind spot in psychopathic behavior. No matter what level of genius they have, there's a clinically well-documented blind spot, and that is this, that there's a near total lack of comprehension as to the consequences of their actions, even to themselves. And this is, again, clinically documented, mm-hmm. a trait of psychopathic person. And that's what we face. And now, while everybody's focused on football games and everything we discussed, we are all in free fall off the cliff right now. I mean, if you jump off a 100-story building, you're not flying. This is about the equation we have right now. The human race thinks that they're somehow in some sustainable position. If you jump off a 100-story building, you might think you're flying until you hit the sidewalk. And I would argue we're passing the second story, and we're about to hit the sidewalk. And that's the realization we face. But as dim as the horizon is, if you have a chance of bettering the situation, no matter how small that chance is, isn't that better to pursue than to do nothing? And this is where my perspectives, I think, don't sit well with a lot of people, because a lot of people want to hear, if we just do A, B, and C, mm-hmm. we'll all live happily ever after. And if you can't guarantee them that, if you can't tell them that, they don't want to do anything to help. And I don't agree with that philosophy. In my mind, if there's the slightest chance, no matter yes. how dark the horizon, if there's the slightest chance that we can affect it for the better, you must try. You have no other option but to try with all your might. It's our duty.
Yes.
It's incumbent upon us. And I hope people look at it with that way, that regardless of the lack of guarantee for a positive outcome, we must try if there's the slightest chance.
That's why we are there. And I think that the only thing left for us, people of the world, is to unite, to get together, as yes. we are doing. That's the reason for which I came, to show support to the board, to you as organizer, and to the people that came from different states and counties, you know, to be part of that. And I think people, as citizens, we have to learn to change our chip in relationship to what is happening, to what we were taught to believe. And now we must really question our beliefs towards our governments and towards even constitutions, you know, that have been drawn in a way that is not being applied. For example, correct. In Spain, well, and I think in all constitutions, military have the right to protect their people. And they are not doing that.
No.
Because politicians, they have engagements, verbal engagements, promises for 4 years. But military people, it's a duty. It's a constitutional duty for them to protect the people. And they are not doing that.
It's because we have, people need to change the whole framework in which they see the governmental system in almost all countries. We don't have countries with governments. We have governments with countries. Does that make sense? We have governments that own countries, not countries that have a government.
Mm-hmm.
It's a mafia family. Basically, it's like different factions of mafia, each with their own country. And that's what we have. So it's the government is not there for the citizens. We see that all too clearly. Now these mafia families, if you will, these governments in various parts of this power structure, I think are starting to fight. That's a good thing from where I'm standing. And that the more division they have, the better chance we have for their power structure disintegrating. And we need that to happen.
Yeah, because one of the problems that we have reaching people is that, it's true, it's a psychological need to find explanation they grasp themselves, they don't believe that the government could do that to them. That's one of the problems that, to create a public opinion on this issue, because people refuse to believe that the governments would do anything, such a thing to them. And they don't understand that not only they could, they are doing it. And they have done it.
They always have.
They always have.
And that blindness is quite astounding, even at this late date when we have historical documentation for biological testing, innocent civilians, and so forth. I mean, it's astounding that people can still remain in such a blind state. The whole industrialized society paradigm was never sustainable. And there's a lot of people that are very still delusional about that. There was no chance of sustaining it. How simple is it to comprehend that you can't have a perpetually expanding economy on a finite planet? I mean, how simple is that?
Yes.
But yet we still hear about this growth rate for this many decades is going to come where? On what planet? The planet is virtually imploding right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I know I've been accused even by former friends, and I say former friends because I have former friends and former family who no longer communicate with me because they simply are not comfortable with reality.
Mm-hmm.
But I have former friends once accuse me of being very, I think the term used was misguided or sick, that I would actually look forward to the collapse of industrialized society.
Mm-hmm.
And I do look forward to that collapse, because if it doesn't happen soon, there'll be nothing left. There'll be no chance to salvage anything. And my response to these people was this: who is really sick or twisted? You, who would rather sacrifice any chance for a future for your children in order for your party to go on 6 months more or a year, or me, I will sacrifice anything, everything, to have any chance of a future for my children, however primitive that existence. I will sacrifice everything immediately to have any chance of that. So what is the more rational perspective? To keep driving the Winnebago motorhomes and to keep using up the resources as fast as we use them up, just to have a little bit better time for a few months or another year? Or to stop now while there's still something left alive, and to try to have something to salvage.
Yes, I understand that.
And the society can't go on. I mean, you can, if you go into the desert with a freezer full of food, you can have a great time for a little while.
That's right.
And when the freezer's out, reality hits, and we're about there. We're literally about there. And even people in the environmental movement, and I consider myself, I've toiled in these forests, in the lands that I have here, this 2,000 acres. Everything has been thinned underneath manually. I've been a part of that, actually running the crews and trying to restore the forest. I care about every single tree. I've probably cut down more trees than most loggers, because I've done that historically with my dad, and this is what this forest needed, because it was irresponsibly logged. So being an environmentalist doesn't mean you don't touch anything.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes things, after they've been put out of balance, need to be put back in. So I've bled, sweat, and cried in this forest for years, but it's all dying now. It's all dying. So the bigger issue is to fight this fight that you're fighting, that I'm fighting. That's the bigger issue. To toil in the forest that's already dying doesn't matter. I know people that are sitting in trees on the coast,
mm-hmm.
trying to save one tree. And although I understand their motive, doesn't it make sense to save the whole forest?
Yeah.
Isn't that a better direction of their effort? And I know so many environmentalists now that don't want to come out of their bubble. They want to save a fish or a frog while the whole planet is destroyed.
Yes.
I don't understand that. And I hope those people find a sense of prioritization. And then there's the other side who feel that you couldn't hurt the environment, that man could never hurt the environment. You've seen that perspective before?
Yes.
How is that possible? People can hold such a perspective when everywhere around us is an environment that is completely imploding. It's hard for me to understand that kind of blindness.
Yes, it is.
So, and you have the same in Spain, I assume.
Yes.
Yeah, I always, I'm so disappointed with much of the American perspective that I always want to hope it's better elsewhere.
No, I don't think we in many aspects we look and we watch what is going on in the States, because sometimes here they are leading aspects of social fights that are not led over there, you know. So finally, this is going to be compensated somehow, you know. And for example, concerning geoengineering, we really watch you. You are our world master, to say it in a way, you know. Your side is the most resourceful side to really find sound information, and out of political or religious connotations. And it's a very good side to just make one's own opinion, informed opinion. And hopefully, you know, what we lived yesterday in the Shasta County Board,
yeah.
We can do it in Europe, because yesterday I was really astonished to see that they took down a roster of people that wanted to intervene, and until the very person, the very last person didn't intervene, they didn't resume. This kind of hearings you don't see in Europe.
I was frankly and pleasantly surprised that it went that way yesterday as well. And I'm grateful to the supervisors for that. And with this job, this position I find myself in, again, I've never been an activist, I've never been politically oriented. And I initially didn't sign my articles that I've, that when I started with Geoengineering Watch, because I didn't, this wasn't about me, it was about the issue.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no interest in the exposure, or it wasn't about notoriety for me at all. I simply wanted to get the word out. But what I found was, unless people know who you are, and they have a face to put with that article and that image,
yeah.
I wasn't able to gain the traction by trying to remain anonymous, if you will. And it wasn't that
mm-hmm.
I was afraid of the exposure, but I just simply, it wasn't about me.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about me. It's mm-hmm. about what's happening in our skies. But I felt people, they seem to relate more if they know who's saying this,
yes.
Know where it's coming from. So what I'm trying to say is I didn't plan any of this. I just simply found myself in this
mm-hmm.
position, and I can't, as I told you earlier, I can't walk into the forest anymore in good conscience and try to enjoy anything, because one, it's dying, and two, so long as I know it's being killed, I have to come back and fight. I can't enjoy anything else while this is going on. I just can't. So I, like you too, I'm sure a calling of conscience you feel as well. So, and I believe now, with conditions unraveling as fast as they are, that other people are realizing that you can't hide from this. You can't
yeah.
hide. You have to answer your conscience. You have to stand, period. We're seeing more of that, thankfully. And people, this is important too. So many people want to have a constant direction of what to do. And what I hope people start to adopt is a feeling of how they can move the ball forward themselves, wherever they're at. That we don't need any particular leader to this, and that we can all fire the best shots we can, if you will, you know, to spread the word as effectively as we can from wherever we're at, given whatever circumstances we're in, so that there are many, many, many heads, many, many tips to our spear, so that all of us can move the ball forward effectively with or without instruction from anywhere else, so that we can start spot fires of awareness, mm-hmm. as I've said before, and the more of those spot fires of awareness we start, it will merge into a blaze that can't be put out. And that's where we need to head. And I think that empowers people when they know that any one of them could be the last pebble that starts the avalanche. Does that make sense?
Yes.
The avalanche of awareness.
Yes, yes. I think yesterday was a good example. And one other thing that astonished me, it was that we found there different speakers, military, pilots, one meteorologist that had been in the army, agricultural people. But what it really impressed me, it was the military, you know. I said, this, I can't believe it. This doesn't happen in Europe.
That was encouraging to me too, because you were there Friday at the presentation on, or not Friday, a Monday night. You were there at that presentation.
Yes.
And you heard this man from Iraq say,
yes,
that.
Yes, it really did touch me. Huh?
It encouraged me to know that clear over there, and even going back several years, they mm-hmm. know, mm-hmm. and they're watching this, and they're looking at it.
Yeah.
It was very encouraging to me to hear that, just to know that we're not screaming in the wilderness, that someone's listening. And every day I wake up and I remind myself this is not a dream, and that every day my motive is to try to find what I haven't done yet, find a way to put a dent in the armor, just another dent, to knock one more stone out from the foundation. And I wait for that day mm-hmm. when that foundation breaks apart. When this comes to light, when this issue comes to light, how galvanizing will that be for society? When that moment of awakening occurs and all those people in denial are forced to face the fact that they have been subjected to a grand and lethal experiment, their children, without their knowledge or consent, and how galvanizing will that be for a society that's fractioned now, once they know that their political beliefs, their political parties, their religious beliefs, nothing has exempted them from what's been done. And that we are all in this together, sink or swim together, and we must unite now. And I wait for that day. If this is the issue, this is the galvanizing issue that could have that effect, that must have that effect.
Actually, we many times in our talks and conference, we really end up pushing for a new Nuremberg, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
A new Nuremberg with civil judges that would try everyone involved in these problems by action and by omission, both.
I so agree with that sentiment, and I've tried to make that known on my radio interviews and so forth, that even those who are not directly involved, if they knew, and if they're participating in any way, shape, or form, and they're omitting a disclosure of this,
yes.
they become accessories.
That's right.
They're part of the crime.
They are part.
And this needs to be looked at in this way, in excuse of ignorance when they should have known, and certainly must have known, is no excuse.
Yes.
And for the record, as I brought up in this meeting yesterday, that Rick Simon, this head of building and safety, who made this talk, who was the reason that Matthew Sutton, the CEO of AECOM, was not there. Well, I was told by Matthew that Rick told him in this conversation that he knew, they know this is going on. And that doesn't surprise me at all, because how could they rationally not know? But there's just too much liability that they don't want to deal with.
This. That's right.
So the same was true with the person who called me from the inside of these programs a week and a half ago. He said the reason the government is struggling so desperately to keep this from coming to light because the liability issue is incomprehensible. Yes, it is. It would change everything with our reality, everything, because everyone has been hurt, everyone. And that's why this issue is so imperative to bring it to light. It will change the flavor of what we face, even though what we face is difficult to imagine. We face global extinction, period. Not necessarily total. We hope we can stop it before it reaches that point. But we are in the sixth great mass extinction, as you know. A lot of people find that hard to believe, but that's a statistical fact. It can't be disputed. So if we could simply bring this issue to light, I think it's the single greatest mechanism by which we can alter the incredibly dire reality we face toward the better. And that doesn't mean it's going to put things back to where they should have been, but you understand.
We'll do our best.
Yes.
We don't do anything else but that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Josefina.
For organizing this event, for having given us the possibility to meet such wonderful people yesterday. Because I was telling Deborah, one of the best things about these trips is the people finally you meet, the human qualities that you thought they were lost. They are not lost. They are there, and people are going to respond, and we are going finally to manage to save what is left of this planet.
I feel exactly the same. I'm just as grateful for you for coming here, and I, you do lose faith in humanity. Many times I've felt I have lost that because so many I know have abandoned their sense of reason, their sense of responsibility, but there are people like you that encourages me, and so long as there are, we continue to fight, and others will wake up. They'll find their sense of humanity. Yes, I'm grateful to you for coming as well, Josefina.